So what is going on, guys, and what is going on, Koi Partners, and welcome back to a brand new episode here on the channel. In this video, I interview Mike. He is the founder of ProBites Koi Food. Mike explains what his vision is about koi food and how you can get your koi large, but above all, healthy. ProBites is available in more than 15 countries, and ProBites is arguably one of the best koi foods out there. This is not a sponsored video, but a video full of very valuable information about koi food. Let yourself be surprised.
Yeah, hello, my name is Mike van Zijl. I'm from the Netherlands, and I'm running a company that produces and develops a high-quality koi food range with some very special properties, and I would love to talk about that some more with you. Officially, I started in 2007. So almost 14 years now. I had a previous run-up with some tests. So actually in 2004 I slowly started to start up with the development and the research I needed to do to find the proper ingredients and to calculate all the recipes for the formula. And in 2007 we started, actually, to keep it short, we started with the frozen koi food. It was the first frozen koi food in the world. And I was a bit green at that moment, because I thought, well, it's not here at the moment worldwide. There was no fresh frozen koi food in the world available. And if you look in the aquaristic scene, you see in all the aquaria shops, you see freezers with frozen koi, with frozen food for the fish. So I thought, why not for the koi? And there's nothing better than fresh frozen koi food. That's how we started. It was very popular in the beginning, and but I never anticipated about the bumps, you know, on the road, because later I realized that there are koi hobbyists that feed a lot of food during a year, some of them even 100 or 200 kilos. So for them it's really quite difficult to store 200 kilos frozen koi food. Although, on the other hand, I met some people that especially bought a freezer to store the frozen koi food. But we started with frozen koi food, and but for transportation, frozen transport is expensive. Shipping overseas, it's all possible, but it costs a lot of money. So, well, it's not a dream, but I expected that there are many countries that already do frozen fish food for aquaria. So it went quite well for some time, and very soon, when I introduced the frozen koi food, very soon, a lot of the companies that sold my food, they asked me if I can make it in a dry form as well. And I didn't want to do that in the beginning, because I said, no, I'm unique with my frozen food, let's stick to that. And the business went well. I don't complain, but if I compare it today, after a while I decided, okay, frozen food, fresh frozen koi food, there's nothing better. Still today, there's nothing better than that. But it has also a lot of complications: feeding machines, storage in freeze houses, transportation, frozen transport. And so after a while, our customers asked me if I could make it in a dry form as well. And there was a certain day and circumstances I decided to do that. So I changed the recipes a little bit to make it in a dry form, and that's what we know today as ProBites. And I'm very happy that I made that decision, because now I can ship it all over the world if I want to, and I have not the problems with frozen storage. Yes, when we entered the market, we found out that most or all of the koi food available worldwide was all for one season. And as good hobbyists should know, is that koi are seasonal animals. Although you live in the tropics, doesn't matter. It's an animal that's koi is cold-blooded, and his digestive system is completely in tune with the water temperature, his surrounding, the pond temperature. And what we missed, first of all, is that there was no difference in food type. Most available foods were or for winter only, or the other one is one food for all seasons. And if you look at nature, you know, let me give you an example. In summer, there's an abundance of natural food available for carp. Our koi is still a carp. And in winter, there's hardly any food available. There is food available, but the type of food and the nutrition value of the natural food in winter is completely different if you compare it with summer. And besides that, the digestive system of a carp is driven by enzymes and bacteria in the gut. Koi don't have any stomach. And the digestive enzymes and bacteria in the gut who are responsible for absorbing the nutrients from the food, they're also dependent on the water temperature. That means in winter there are hardly any digestive enzymes available present in the koi to digest food. And in the summer there are abundance of the digestive system is on its maximum in summer, and in the winter it slows down. And that gives actually the answer for the question why we need seasonal food. So we started to develop food that's also tailor-made for the water temperature and the according season. Here in Holland or in Europe we have summer, winter, spring, autumn. And besides the tropics where it's always hot, people there should be careful also what to feed. But that's why we developed a complete koi food range that's tailor-made to the according water temperature and the seasons. So we have spring, autumn for 10 to 15 Celsius water temperature, or 15 to 10, it's the same temperature range. We have a summer food that's from 15 Celsius and up, and we have a very special winter food and some varieties on that, a very good growth food as well. But the main thing was to make specific food that's tailor-made for the water temperature. Another thing that that struck us is that it's common practice in fish food that a breeder of commercial fish farms, when they use food, they use food that should be as cheap as possible. And they want to get the best results. That means growth and fattening a fish in a short period with at the least amount of money. So they always look at the food to make it as cheap as possible. And you see that also when you look at the koi food market. Most of the koi foods today are still a variety on commercial carp food, which is not suitable for koi for long term. And cheap food. Another thing is that most of the ingredients used to produce fish food are coming from the feed industry, and that means that you have a difference between feed quality, that's for cows and animals. Everything you and I are not allowed to eat, we give to the animals, including the koi, including the fish. When you look at food quality ingredients, that's everything that's suitable for mankind to eat. That means much higher quality, and the hygiene and control, the supervising of the quality, and those institutes are very strict. But the main reason is that main thing for us is that the quality of food quality ingredients is much better, and of course those ingredients are more expensive than ingredients used for the feed quality. But we because we know that carp can grow very old if you take care of them responsibly, we found that We always say we don't mind if you buy a koi for $10 or you buy a koi for $100,000. It's still a koi and it needs a good environment and it needs good food. So we decided to use as much ingredients that are fit for human consumption in our recipes, in our formulas. Then and although we can't skip some special ingredients like fish meal, but even then the fish meal we use the best there is. You have different qualities in fish meal as well and other fish products, and we decided to choose for the best quality freeze-dried products also for human consumption, like shrimp meal that's used to make sauces and soup. That's a different kind than the shrimp meal, which are only the leftovers from the shrimping industry, which are the heads and the tails and the legs and the outer skin, which is a complete different quality. So we had that idea in mind. Another important factor of our food is that we believe that the sugar content in almost every koi food on the world is much too high. And that lays in the fact that to make a pellet or to make a koi food, you need carbohydrates. And the most common carbohydrates used to make koi food are wheat bran, every grain product that's available, soya products are available. But people don't realize that carbohydrates consist of starches and sugars. And let me say, first of all, very important that koi or carp don't find any grains or carbohydrates in their natural diet. But we as a producer, we need it, because not only is it an energy provider, it also acts as a binder to keep all the other ingredients together for us to make to be able to make a pellet. And we decided that if you look at koi foods, by law it's not mandatory to state your sugar levels on a koi food. And we did, because we did a lot of research, and we picked only the carbohydrates with as low sugar content as possible. And that's why we are proud to state our sugar content on the packaging as well. And it's possible to do it, you know, if you look the right way, and if you test enough and you find the right combination, you can use carbohydrates with very low sugar levels. And later I will explain why sugars are so devastating to the health of koi. So in a nutshell, that's actually the philosophy about our koi food and the high quality. And our motto is always that quality will prove itself. You know, I can talk a lot about my koi food, but it's eventually the hobbyist with their own koi and their own pond which decide which brand or which food is good and will do what the producer says it will do. Well, to answer what a koi hobbyist should look for in a koi food, when you enter a shop, a pond shop or a koi food shop, you see a lot of packages, and they're all bright, and they all have lovely koi on the front. And some prize-winning koi are pictures of prize-winning koi on the front labels. But the most important thing is the backside of the packaging. You should pick a package and look at the backside and look at the analysis which is on the back of the food you want to buy. Very important is that you get a complete analysis, and that means that if you add up all the ingredients, for example the carbohydrates, the lipid content, the vitamins, the fibers, the protein content, if you add them up, you should come close to 100%. You know, it's just a matter of adding up the percentages which are stated on the packaging. If you're not coming close to 100%, you have to ask yourself why. Why do I miss a certain? Because all food consists of 100%. Koi food also consists of 100% ingredients. And most of the time you miss about 40, 50, 60% of ingredients percentage. And those are mostly the carbohydrates which are not stated on the packaging. Well, you should wonder yourself, why does a producer of koi food doesn't state the carbohydrate content or the percentage of carbohydrates in their food? So look at the analysis, that's the most important thing, and add up all the percentages and see if you come close to 100%. If you have an honest and an open analysis with no hiding of information, you should come close to 100%. Another thing is that most hobbyists, they all look at the protein content of a koi food. And one thing they're focused on, because they understandably think that if the protein content of a koi food is very high, it should be good koi food. Well, that's not wrong in the first place, but if the most important thing is don't look only at the protein content, but look where comes the protein from. What's the source of the protein? That's very important. If you look at the back again of the packaging and you look at the analysis, a good koi food should state not only the protein content, but also the source of the proteins. And the reason why that's so important, because in many koi foods also derived from carp, commercial carp food, is that they use a lot of very bad quality proteins, because proteins are the most expensive ingredient in any koi food, in animal food. So they used chicken feather meal, bone meal, blood meal, Slaughter offal is also often used. Those are all protein sources that come from warm-blooded animals. And again, a koi will never encounter a cow or a chicken or a pig underwater. It's not a part of their natural diet. The problem with those kind of proteins is that the protein structure of warm-blooded animals is, look at it as a long string, you know, and once it enters the gut of the koi, there are enzymes. They have to gut the protein structure into its essential amino acid pattern. And that means that the enzymes have a lot of difficulty to cut it up in the essential pieces to be absorbed by the body. So, for a long story to keep it short, proteins that are derived from land animals, which is not a good protein source. You have vegetable proteins. A koi is an omnivorous animal. It can eat vegetable matter and it will eat animal matter. But if you look at the natural diet of carp, our koi is still a carp, you will see that the main protein source they encounter in their natural diet is more than 60-70%. It's aquatic proteins, you know, snails and little insects that has their larva stadia underwater. Fish, of course, is a good example. Let me give that example. A koi is a fish, you know. If you use very high quality fish meal, which is made from fish, whole fish, that's the best quality. The koi is a fish, and his whole body and his whole protein structure is exactly the same as the fish meal you give in his food. So the enzymes has no problem at all to digest those proteins, and the growth will be phenomenal on that type of proteins. So the best proteins to look for, no matter how high the percentage is, but the best protein source you can give a koi is all protein sources that are derived from water, the sea or the lakes. And I mean fish meal, crustaceans, shrimps, shellfish, gammaras, krill, squid meal, all those animals, that's part of their natural diet. And you will see with your own eyes that you will have much better growth. It's healthier and it's easier for the koi to digest and to convert it into body mass, because eventually everybody wants his koi to grow well. Another thing to notice if you buy a koi food is when you hear that a lot, is that people complain about foam on the surface of the pond. And that's always the problem with bad quality proteins. Because proteins that are not utilized by koi in their feed, they're excreted and they foul the pond water, and you will see that as a foam on the surface, and that's an indication of bad quality or the wrong type of proteins in fish food. So you better go for I always suggest between 40% and 50% of protein content. But more important is the source of the proteins. Look at that. If it's not on the packaging, I advise people not to buy that kind of food, because you never know what kind of proteins they are used. Yeah, winter. Winter's a very, it's the most difficult period for koi in Europe, besides the tropics. It's always warm. That comes with its own problems. But it's a pity to see that in Europe, every year in springtime, there are a lot of people with koi that are ill, parasites, or even worse, dying koi, or koi that are completely covered in open wounds and ulcers. And one of the reasons is that the wrong food in the wintertime, and also the preparation for the winter. Many hobbyists, they don't realize that a koi is already building up his nutrient pool for the winter time in summer. You don't realize that. So that means in summer you have to feed your koi high quality koi food. Why? Because if you feed a high quality koi food, not only needs that quality and the ingredients and everything that needs to be in there to sustain his daily routine, to swim around, to eat, to digest, and But it also needs some extra, some surplus, which he can take up in the body and save it for a rainy day, in this case the winter. What happens is that many people still feed in Europe then, I'm talking about Europe and the winter climate here, many people unfortunately still use a lot of wheat germ pellets to feed their koi. I wrote an article about wheat germ because if you look at the natural diet, and I said it before, a carp is omnivorous, it can eat vegetable matter and animal-based food. But the main source of their diet is animal origin. You know, they hardly eat any vegetable food, and also underwater, what they eat on vegetables, it's not because the vegetable matter is very nutritious. But it's because there is detritus and biofilm on that. And if you see carp in the wild that scavenge between the plants underwater, they do it because there are little insects hiding there, not for the plants itself. It hardly the nutritional value of the plants underwater, which a koi digest, it's hardly noticeable. So the most problems already start in summer. If you buy and feed cheap food, you know, the koi already has difficulties to gain their daily intake and the nutrients they need to growth and to especially to maintain their own immune system. That's very important, because we hopefully can only provide a good living environment for them, clean water, a lot of water refreshment, and give them a suitable surrounding to live in. That's one thing. The other thing is good food, because only by supplying a good quality koi food will give your koi the opportunity to maintain its own defense system, and that's partly the slime, the mucus layer, the slime coat of a koi, which has defensive properties to keep parasites at bay. And it's important that the nutrients they need to maintain that mucus layer, it's in the food, so minerals are very important for that. But bear in mind that in the summer they already are working on building up a nutrient pool, not a fatty layer, because they don't feel the cold as we do. So a lot of problems begin in the autumn, you know, and when the winters are very long, it's very a harsh environment for koi. And although koi can thrive at very low water temperatures and very high water temperatures, you have an optimum range also. And the optimum range, in my opinion, lies between a minimum water temperature of about 6 Celsius. Preferably 10 Celsius. Don't leave them at lower temperatures, because that's devastating for their body. But what happens in the winter when lots of people feed wheat germ? Why do they feed wheat germ? If you ask them, why do you feed wheat germ? Most of them say, yeah, the Japanese do it also. But they forget that Japanese breeders, they take all their fish inside the fish houses, and they don't leave them outside in the mud ponds in the winter with ice on top. You know, the koi will definitely die. And we have the same situation here. Our winters are harsh, cold water, which is really an attack on their body and their overall health. So when you feed wheat germ, look at nature again. You know, in the winter, when you look at the natural diet for carp, what is available? There's no plant matter available anymore, because in autumn it already dies back. All the insects that has their larval stadia underwater, they're flown out in summer, they're not there anymore. If you look at the winter food, which we did with our winter food ourselves, if you look at the food sources available for carp in winter, there's no vegetable matter, it's died off. There are no insects, they're flown away, they fly out of the water and they're gone. What still remains underwater available as a food source for carp is clams, mussel, ik weet niet hoe je mussel zegt in het Engels, maar ik dacht dat het clams was, crustaceans, shrimp-like creatures, and there are some insects still available for koi or carp in the winter at very low water temperatures, which can withstand the low water temperatures. Well, those natural food sources consist about 60% of protein, and there's hardly any vegetable matter. So when you feed wheat germ, which is a vegetable product, it's a nice product, but not to feed your koi all winter. What will happen is, first of all, the digestive enzymes are not able to cope with vegetable matter. So if you feed wheatgerm whole winter long in Europe at cold water temperatures, your koi will get skinny.
They will lose weight
because the digestive enzymes are not present to digest vegetable matter in that amount. So they need a diet which is more tailor-made for cold water temperatures and what carp still have as a food source in nature. So that means that they need high quality body identical proteins with a high net protein utilization. All aquatic proteins, of course, and just a little bit vegetable protein is no problem. That way they don't lose weight, they can maintain their own defense system, especially in spring when water temperatures are fluctuating, which is very bad for koi because koi is a very strong and resilient animal. But one thing they really hate is fluctuations in their environment, you know, like temperature. They don't like that, and when they don't like it, they get stressed. So what happens in spring is that they were not fed properly in the summer. They get the wrong diet in autumn or in the winter. And they will lose weight and they lose their complete defense system. Then in spring, when the water temperature rises, the parasites are the first ones to wake up and will attack the weakened koi. And that's a thing that happens every time. So on one thing, the most important thing is to feed your koi properly, a proper winter food. And I only produce sinking winter food because when you notice in the winter, your koi will go down in your pond and stay most of the time there on the bottom. And that's all because they want to save energy. So if you feed floating food in the winter, you force your koi to spend all that energy to swim up to the surface and eat the pellets. That's not natural also, because it's a bottom feeder. Originally, a carp and a koi are bottom feeders. They're completely equipped to find their food on the bottom. They can find it in midwater, they can find it in the surface, and they can take it there. But it's for our convenience to feed floating food. And that's also why we have a sinking range, but I will come to that later. So feed your koi in the winter, especially developed food that is tailor-made for the low water temperatures. And please stop feeding your koi at 6 Celsius water temperature, because below that temperature, carp and koi can't digest any food at all. If you maintain feeding, if you keep feeding and they will eat it, you have a great risk that food starts rotting in the gut, and with all the problems that comes from that. So, but I will explain our winter food later. I will show you why we developed this special winter food and why it's sinking. It's obvious. When they're in rest at the bottom, you don't want to force them to go up to the surface to find some food. Just present it on the bottom and they will eat it slowly and easily. Not too much, but so that's my vision about winter food.